I'm Tom Vasel. Welcome to Board Game Breakfast, episode 200. Okay, so lots of stuff to go over today, and a couple things. Because it's a 200th episode, I invited all the contributors to the Dice Tower to send some stuff in, so you might see some segments from people that you don't normally do, but we just thought it would be fun to do. This is my favorite show to put together. I just love the idea of it. I always thought when I first came up with the idea, we were doing our podcast, and our podcast was a sort of variety show. And I said, wow, maybe we can move that variety show to the video format. Got a lot of negative feedback, but we persevered, and we still get negative feedback, of course, as time goes by, but I still really enjoy doing this show. And I really want to send out a big thank you to all our contributors. Speaking of that, there's two contributors, particularly have different things that you might want to look at. I don't often mention Rob Searing. He's our webmaster. You don't see him very often. He's behind the scenes. Does a really fantastic job putting together that. He also runs Dice Tower News, the website. But he does inserthere.me. This is where he makes the foam core inserts, which really are, when you put them in a game, you can barely tell they're there. It makes the whole game lighter, but it also organizes your stuff. So you should check out his things. And Berkey, who has done board game theater here on Board Game Breakfast in the past, is running a Kickstarter right now, which for some reason I missed when I did my crowd surfing segment last week. So it's almost over, but he has these new table toppers. So I have these really big, nice gaming tables, but they're expensive. They're heavy. They're hard to move around. They're great though, right? But his table toppers, you put on top of another table. So you have those, like those white Costco banquet tables. These fit right on top and make it look like one of those fancy tables. And they do a really good job. I've seen them in person. If you were at Gen Con this year, you saw them everywhere. They're fantastic. Definitely check out his Kickstarter. And since we're on this advertising kick here, the Geek and Son, who makes some of the tables that you've seen in our videos, they're having a camp in Poland next year in September. I did a video about it last week, but if you missed that, go check it out. It is like, if you look at it, I saw some people say it's really expensive. It is, but it's like going on a cruise, right? You go there, everything's provided. You go to this camp, there's horseback riding, there's food, there's spas, and there's gaming, and I'm going to be there helping run. I think I'm in charge of the gaming. Maybe we'll see. I'm going to bring in some board games and play them the whole time and do seminars and things. It's going to be fantastic. Definitely, especially if you're in Europe, consider doing this as a fantastic vacation next year. Okay. Well, all that needs being said, let's get to the news. The biggest news of the week is WizKids and Games Workshop are teaming up. Now, WizKids, Games Workshop used to have a relationship with Fantasy Flight Games to publish a lot of board games in their universes, and they broke that off, I think, a year ago. So some companies have picked up different things. Yellow's doing some stuff. Other companies have done things, or Devil Pig specifically is doing something. This is a thing that they're doing with 40K specifically, Warhammer 40,000, and they've announced that in 2018 there will be two brand new board games, but they're also going to be bringing back Relic, which I was a little surprised about because I thought Relic was a Fantasy Flight property, but I guess it's just Talisman in the 40K universe, so there you go. But Fury of Dracula, so yay! Stop buying those outrageously priced ones in the secondhand market. A new version will be coming out. And then I said that they're going to be doing stuff with their dice games. I don't know if we're going to see 40K Dice Masters or if we're going to see 40K Quarriors or something along that line. Who knows? But this is very interesting to see what's going to be happening here in the future. Back to Fantasy Flight, though. The Legends of the Five Rings. This is their new living card game that they're pushing out. And with their living card games, they publish usually one new cycle a month, right? So you can buy things on a monthly basis. It's not random. You just get it. And, you know, if you buy them all, it can be expensive. They're jump-starting the L5R universe. What they're doing is they are putting these out, but every week. So instead of six packs over 6 months, they're doing six cycles in 6 weeks. This is crazy. I guess it's working. I haven't seen people really complaining about it. I don't know that I would want to play a game where I had to buy that much content that quickly. But hey, I guess then maybe that's a way to be like, there's a ton of material for this. All right, now let's calm down and do one a month. We'll see. The Ruins of Thandar is a new expansion for Hero Realms. This changes the game considerably. It's coming out. It's going to make it co-op and give it a campaign setting. So I don't know if that will work with Hero Realms. We'll have to wait and see. Then there's also new decks for the Dragon Boss and Lich Boss coming. We've talked in the past about the Catan movie. Well, Sony is now vying for the rights of it. If they sign it, Gail Katz would be the director and everything. I'm still trying to figure out what kind of plot exists in Catan. Has anyone played this game? You trade. There's no plot. Whatever. Let's see. Fantasy Flight. Back to Fantasy Flight. They are releasing Arkham Novellos. These are short novels about the Arkham horror universe, but supposedly they're not as bleak as the Lovecraft ones, and I hear the characters fight back just like they do in the Fantasy Flight games. Hooray! The first one is from David Gross, who I don't know if he's written other books, but he's done RPGs and a lot of writing for games in the past, and it stars Jenny Barnes, who's one of my favorite characters from the Fantasy Flight Arkham universe, so that's good. It's called Hour of Huntress, but there's a whole series of these. There's also a mini expansion coming out for Feast for Odin, which I was kind of excited about. Then I saw it was just two more little boards. Great. I'll get them added to my game. Doesn't change the game much. You could probably miss it. But more importantly, TN Trade expansion has been announced for Fields of Arl. This is an expansion that adds tea and a whole lot of other stuff to Fields of Arl. But Fields of Arl was an exclusively two-player game. This TN Trade makes it now a three-player game. I have no idea how that's going to work because the board for Fields of Arl was very specifically set up so you sat on one side, the other person sat on the other side. It was two-player. I don't know. We'll have to wait and see. But that is interesting, because Fields of Arl with three players, that could really make it move up higher in my top games of all time. But finally, last Monday, to be precise, a week ago from today, a new Cool Stuff store opened in Miami, in Kendall, Florida. So I'm very, very excited about that. Went there. Fantastic store. Fantastic staff. Quiet, wonderful. We had a great meetup. If you're ever in the area, every Tuesday, there's a meetup, a board game meetup. I won't be there this week because of Essen. So much. There's just a lot of things going on. But I will be there as often as I possibly can, playing games. Can't wait to see you there. All right, let's keep going on.
Everybody, and happy 200th breakfast to us all. Congratulations, Tom, and all of the contributors, both past and present, for helping achieve this pretty awesome milestone. I've been part of Board Game Breakfast for a lot of those 200 episodes, and I do want to take a moment just to say thank you. Thank you to Tom for giving me this opportunity, and thank you to the amazing Board Game Breakfast community, which includes all of you. Thank you for watching, for your feedback, for your support over the years. I can't tell you how much fun and how much of an honor it is to be part of this show and this community. It's really something important in my life, and I'm so glad that you are part of it. So thank you. All right, I definitely have some really cool games to look at today, so let's get going. Detective City of Angels is a story-driven game set in 1940s LA. Players take on the roles of homicide detectives solving big cases. Each game has a narrative, including background, suspects, locations, and more. Detectives are going to move around the city and search, question suspects, get kickbacks, make bribes, and conceal evidence even, just to stay ahead. And a player wins when they use their solve token to correctly identify the suspect, weapon, and motive. But one player is the Chisel, who controls the suspects and decides when they lie or tell the truth. They help craft the narrative as the game goes on. And if the detective guesses wrong about the suspect's answers, it'll make the case harder to solve. Detective includes a solo cooperative casebook and grid cards that simulate that Chisel player, and the art by Vincent Dutre is gorgeous and atmospheric. you can get a basic copy of Detective City of Angels for $64 plus shipping, or the hard-boiled edition that includes the Bullets Over Hollywood expansion for $89 plus shipping. Tsukuyomi Full Moon Down is set in a world where the moon has crashed into the earth. In the devastation remaining, players take on the role of unique factions, each of which plays differently and has a complete backstory. You'll be conquering territories and completing missions for points, using action cards that allow you to recruit, move, and attack across the modular board. In a unique battle mechanism, each faction has a set of battle cards, but instead of dice or other resolution methods, the attacker picks the outcome of the battle, but the defender picks the price of that victory from the choices on the card. The makers of Tsukuyomi have put a lot of effort into world building, including a graphic novel that they're hoping to translate beyond German. You can get a copy of the Tsukuyomi base game for a pledge of €59 plus shipping, but this campaign has a wide variety of pledge levels to check out if you're interested. Overbooked is a strategy puzzle game all about optimizing passenger seating on a jetliner. Passenger cards indicate a seating pattern, with each color of token representing a different type of passenger. Players will procure cards from a sliding market, and the pattern of the card tells you where you must place passengers. You can rotate the card any way you want, but if you end up having to seat a passenger where there's already a token, they go into the overbooked area. Scores based on passenger count and special patterns like matched couples and children being surrounded by adults. But those overbooked passengers cost you points. A copy of Overbooked takes a pledge of $35. The slicing action of the Fruit Ninja app is being brought into the analog world in not just one, but three different games from Lucky Duck Games. All are intended to capture the energy of the app, but feature different mechanisms. Cardmaster is a speed and deck building game. Cards represent both the slice and the fruit, and you'll build your deck to leverage both smartly to win control over different dojos for points and money. While there is a speed element, the deck building is meaningful. I've actually played the prototype, and this is one that my game group quite enjoyed. Slice and Dice is a simultaneous dice rolling game where players are trying to gain combo cards in sequences. And Combo Party is a bit like the Game of War, as players play fruit cards, and if there's a match, they grab for the Suka stick and get bonus rewards. Meanwhile, the Push Your Luck element has players choosing whether to score their cards as is, and there's also a drafting element because cards not played will be passed on. You can get any single Fruit Ninja game for $29, up to $69 for all three games. And the team at HGN Games is bringing back a classic Richard Berg game, Medieval. For full disclosure, the team at HGN Games are the same people I help run a local convention with. Medieval has been out of print for a while, and it's a card-based area control game. Cards provide actions and money and can expand on available territories. Attacking options are tight, and there can be a lot of above-the-table negotiations as people clamor for control, and you have events that pop up as well. And ultimately, the game is a bit of a race because the Mongol hordes sweep through the land from the east and will eventually trigger the end game. This new edition of Medieval features art by Beth Sobel and has fully updated graphics throughout. HGN views this new edition as a passion project, and you can get a copy of the game for a pledge of $65 plus shipping. Alrighty, that's all I've got for you this episode. And hey, if you're attending the Spiel at Essen, I do hope that you'll stop by the Dice Tower booth because I would love to meet you. Until next time, I hope you have a wonderful week.
Chaz Marler from Pair of Dice Paradise here, and did you know that for the past 3 months, the card-driven story adventure game, The Seventh Continent, has just dominated the top position on Board Game Geek's hotness list? The hotness list tracks which games on the Board Game Geek website are getting the most traffic. But this isn't the only chart that The Seventh Continent has been topping recently. On October 19th, publisher Serious Pulp completed a Kickstarter campaign for the second printing of The Seventh Continent, making the game available to over 43,000 backers who wouldn't have obtained a copy of the game otherwise. And that's because the Seventh Continent is one of several Kickstarter-topping games that are not planned to have a hobby trade release. And this means that the only place that this game will be available from is the company's Kickstarter. Now, in an article posted on the Geek News website, icv2.com, it was reported that the Seventh Continent's co-designer, Bruno Sauter, stated in an email that the manufacturing costs caused by the game's enormous size and amount of content make retail distribution cost prohibitive. That's fair. And ICV2 goes on to report that the developer of Kingdom Death Monster, Adam Poots, has expressed similar concerns, stating, quote, "A game this size could not feasibly be made without the community of supportive backers that we found on Kickstarter. It's just too expensive to produce and too vivid for distribution." Now, another thing that these two games share, besides both bypassing traditional retail trade channels, is that they are currently two of the three highest-grossing board game Kickstarter projects of all time. The Seventh Continent's backers spent an average of $161 on the game, and Kingdom Death Monster's backers pitched in an average of $643 each. And that's not even a typo. That's the actual number. Additionally, the company Monolith, who published the 11th current highest-grossing board game Kickstarter of all time, last year's Conan, has stated that their upcoming Batman the Board Game will also only be available through Kickstarter. So, all right. Are we witnessing the beginning of a new trend here? Are these two games, with their higher-than-average price point and circumvention of the traditional distribution model, indicative of what we are bound to see happen to the rest of the industry in months to come? After all, 70% of the current top 10 highest-grossing board game Kickstarter campaigns took place within just the last 24 months. And 8 of these top 10 Kickstarters have an average pledge of over $100. Heck, half of them have an average of over $175. Does this have an impact on the rest of the board game industry? Well, I don't know. But what I do know is that when Fantasy Flight Games released the second edition of Mansions of Madness at Gen Con 2016, it was revealed with a $100 price point. But it sold. And sold pretty darn well. And at Gen Con this year, there were even more board games with a three-digit price point released. So, are the high-profile, high-price-point Kickstarters by independent and established publishers helping to nudge the average board game price upwards with fewer options available to consumers of where to buy from until this all just becomes the new normal for the board game industry? How much are the big-ticket board games revealed at Gen Con next year going to cost? And how many different outlets will customers be able to purchase them from? Well, I don't know that either, but us and our wallets are gonna find out.
Two brothers set loose in a thrift store. This is Thrift Store Throwbacks.
Hey, what is that?
I don't know, some kind of raccoon or something?
I'm not at all convinced that that creature is of this earth.
Huh. Think we can cook it?
I don't know. Maybe.
Oh, get back now. That thing is still alive. That thing is still alive. Get... Go, man, run. It's got double the normal amount of teeth.
So this is Roadkill. Roadkill is a roadkill-themed board game where each player gets their own road. This is my road. This is Mike's road. And it's a card-driven game where you're going to be playing cards on your road and everyone else's roads. The goal of the game is to have the least amount of roadkill on your road. So on your turn, you can play a roadkill card on someone else's board, but then they can go ahead and play a live raccoon card right on top of that roadkill, and oh, he's alive again, but then he can just play another dead card on top of it, and this raccoon is having the worst life. You can also play things like trucks on top of roadkill, which makes it so no one can ever change that card again. That truck is just sitting on top of it forever and ever and ever. You can also play things like veterinarians, so if you have some roadkill and you have a veterinarian, you can come and revive that roadkill, and then they go discarded, and then now you don't have that roadkill on your board anymore. You can play sign cards, which just go and take up a spot on your road. It can never be moved. You can also play a scraper, which comes and scrapes up all the roadkill on one half of your board. The round ends once someone has 8 cards on their road, and the game takes place over 3 rounds. Whoever has the least amount of fatalities on their roads at the end of the game wins. So that was roadkill.
Oh,
never mind.
I hit my teeth.
You about to be roadkilled next.
I'm weirdly charmed by these boards. I don't know why.
It's a quick, it's very mean, it's very take that, but again, it's extremely light. You're playing dead animals and they're reviving them, then you're like, dead again.
That's gonna be it for us, but first, we got an announcement.
We are gonna be going to Unrivaled, put on by Oomba, which is a company that puts on board game tournaments. We're going and representing the Dice Tower. We're really, really excited. We're going out to Vegas.
Just come check us out. If you're there, do say hello. We'll be the guys that look like this.
And until next time,
see you in the raccoon jerky making station.
Hey gang, and welcome to Tantrum House. I'm Sarah Meadows.
And I'm Ryan Pills, and today on the Throwdown, we've got Resistance in the red corner.
And Crossfire in the blue corner. Crossfire from Plaid Hat Games is a quick action social deduction card game for 5 to 10 players. At the beginning of the game, players are given a card to look at. They then immediately rotate cards to the left. Players have 3 minutes to discuss before guns are drawn and characters are revealed. Each character has a specific goal, but only a few of them will achieve it.
Don Eskridge's The Resistance is another social deduction game for 5 to 10 players. Each player is assigned randomly by card draw to be either a spy or resistance operative. Each round has a team building phase and a mission phase. In the team building phase, the leader nominates players to go on each mission, and the group votes whether to accept or reject the team. If the team is rejected, the leader switches to the next player, but if it is accepted, the team goes on to the mission phase and determines if it was a success or failure. The first team to get 3 of their desired outcomes, failure for spies and success for operatives, wins.
So we're looking at 2 different secret identity party games. I know which one I enjoy more. Let's do the Throwdown.
Yeah, let's do it.
Three, two, one. Throwdown.
Yeah, I thought that was pretty obvious what we were going to do. I like the Resistance more because up to this point, I'd only ever played Mafia as a social deduction game, never played anything else. And the Resistance showed me that you could play a social deduction game without eliminating players. So it just has a very special place in my heart. But the Crossfire is a great game too. What do you like about Crossfire?
I love that in Crossfire, the whole game is played in less than 5 minutes. You can get multiple plays in a very short amount of time. And there's still the banter that goes on between players and the lying and deception, so it makes it a lot of fun.
Yeah. Thanks for joining us. Be sure to subscribe to our channel, and we'll see you next time.
What's coming from the Dice Tower this week? Well, this week we're going to be at the Essen Fair, and I'll talk a little bit more about that later. Actually, I'll just talk about that right now. So, Essen. We're going to be there. We're going to be in Hall 7 at booth H106. So please come by and say hi to us. We'll have promos there. You can find our schedule online if you want to see who's going to be at the booth and when. I will be there. Eric will be there. Sam, Mandy, Z, Suzanne, Jason, Kenny, lots of folks, contributors from Dice Tower will be there. So we would love to see you guys. We're very excited about that. So that's going on this week. We're going to be there. We're going to be doing a show live on Friday at 4 o'clock. If you want tickets to that show, you just have to come by our booth. The tickets are free. And it's first come, first served. Friday morning, we'll be handing out those tickets. So on our channel here, there's going to be fewer reviews this week from us. But you'll see stuff going up throughout the course of the week. I'm going to be doing my top 260 to top 100 because I feel like those games don't get talked about as much as the top 100 does. We're also going to be finishing the top 100, so that's exciting. Can't wait to see that, you know, done with in our top 10 of all time. Will there be any changes or will it be the same old, same old? You'll have to come by and see. And of course, our show, our podcast goes up Tuesday. And so there's lots of other things going on. Next week, Board Game Breakfast will be delayed by a day at least, maybe a little bit longer. We'll do a Halloween board game breakfast. It'll probably come out on the 31st. But anyhow, that's what you can expect to see. Let's move on.
How can you really creep out your players this Halloween season? Hi, I'm Chris Renshaw from the Boards and Swords podcast, and this is Role Playing. Halloween time's among us, and that means it's time for spooky games. That's right, games that'll put a shiver down your players' spines. But what game do you choose? I mean, granted, you could put a horror in any kind of RPG with the right tweaks, but What if you want a game that's designed for that kind of genre? Now, an obvious answer might be Call of Cthulhu by Chaosium, especially if you're into Arkham Horror, Eldritch Horror, Arkham Horror the card game, all those kinds of things, that Cthulhu mythos, then Call of Cthulhu is definitely. But instead, I want to recommend a little bit more of an indie game, and that's, I want to talk about a game called 10 Candles. You can search for this online. It's a really unique game in that basically the game revolves around having 10 D6s and having a story with, you have a bowl in the middle and 10 candles surrounding it. And the GM sets the story. It's usually some sort of horrible scenario. Maybe you're on a yacht and things go crazy. Or maybe you're in space where no one can hear you do anything, I guess. But as the story goes along, anytime you fail a check, a candle goes out. And you lose a die, so thus reducing the chances that you'll be able to succeed on the next one. So what happens is you slowly and slowly, as the candles get put out, when all the candles are gone, the entire party dies. So it's not a question of, will the party survive? The party's not going to survive. It's all about, what are you gonna do as you know you're approaching your sudden demise? What games are you playing this Halloween season? Let me know down in the comments below. And make sure you also follow me on all the different social media. And let me know what kinds of games you're playing and how they're going. Because in the meantime, may all your hits be crits.
Hello everyone, my name's Annette, and you may know me as Netter's Plays. And today on Applied Mechanics, I'm going to go over Chimera Station. So Chimera Station is a worker placement game. And that's one of my favorite game mechanisms. However, there's something a little different with this game that makes it very unique, and that's the worker itself. So let me show you a little bit about this game. So here's the whole setup of the main game. You have your main player board and your specific player mat. So every player is going to begin with a starting set of resources, it being either coins, a genetic component, or even cheeseburgers. The worker splicing lab is one of the most interesting spots on the board because you can place your worker there and then genetically modify them. When you place a worker on the cargo bay, then you'll acquire 2 coins along with 2 cheeseburgers. And if you place a genetically modified worker with tentacles, you'll acquire 1 more coin and even 1 more cheeseburger. In case an opponent is at a location you like to go to, no problem, because you can always use your genetically modified claws in order to kick them out. The worker with leaves not only will give you the benefits of the tile, but you'll never have to worry about feeding them. And the worker with brains will give you the points that are located on the tile. So not only does it matter where you go, but also what type of worker goes there. So as you can see, Chimera Station is just like any other worker placement out there, except for the workers themselves. Because they're modular, you can make this game different and unique every time you play it. And that's why I like the game. Well, thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you next time. Bye!
So interestingly enough, a few weeks ago, I made an offhand comment about the online community and how I thought it was very welcoming, and I got a lot of feedback, and I thought it was actually ironic. Some people said that the online community was awful, and they cursed at me and yelled at me online doing so, which I think kind of proves the point, maybe. And I know that as time goes by, we make a lot of jokes about Reddit, and sometimes Board Game Geek, Reddit, and I'm talking about the board game community specifically, there can be mean and nasty things that happen in those places, and Facebook forums, they make Reddit look like Disney World. And that can happen on those, right? People's worst things can come out online. It definitely happens. I was talking to my wife yesterday. I said, is Facebook anything other than just a complaint-filled session? But be that as it may, I thought for the 200th episode of Board Game Breakfast that I do want to extol a lot of benefits of the online gaming community. It really is cool. It's really fantastic. And I think too often we allow ourselves to get distracted by all the negatives that are out there. And there's definitely negatives, there's definitely mean people. Although, again, compared to so many other communities, the board game community is absolutely awesome. Are they perfect? They're not. I had to talk about that last week. It's been talked about. There are a lot of problems in the online board gaming community, but there are a lot of amazing things too. Number one, informational purposes. The internet, I still believe this, people can talk about all sorts of things being responsible for the growth of the industry. The internet is number one. I don't even see how anyone can dispute this fact. Because of the internet and the information that's out there, that now with the internet, whenever I go somewhere, I know where the game stores are. I can go there. Now with the internet, I can go and find out about games and reviews of games. The internet was really coming into its own in the 90s, and that corresponding with the release of Magic the Gathering and Settlers of Catan, I think those three things together just really blew board gaming wide open. How do you find out about different things that are happening? How do you find out about conventions? How do you find out about board games? The internet is there and it's amazing. I want to know if there's a game about this, I can go online and talk about it. And it's just so handy. The internet's a useful information tool. And yeah, there's a lot of bad information on the internet, but when it comes to board games and facts about board games and opinions about board games, there is so much there. And that's just a fascinating tool that we really almost take for granted. My kids can't even imagine a time without being able to go and say, I wonder if someone reviewed this. Yes, someone did. I wonder if this has happened. I don't have to look in a newspaper and say, oh, they reviewed that movie 3 weeks ago in a newspaper. That's gone now. I can go back and look at reviews of things for weeks and months. They stay there. And that huge amount of information and finding very specific things is very helpful. If I want to say, go on the internet and say, I like to play games with my wife and our two pals who live across the street, and they like cooperative games, and I like games about science fiction, and my wife likes games that involve stabbing people in the back. What can we get? And someone will be like, this is the game. That's such a handy thing to have. Number two is like-minded people. You know, you sometimes might feel like you're the only person. You're unique, and we're all unique in our own ways, but there's a lot of people like us out there, right? Conventions are certainly an exhibit of this. You go to a convention, look around, you're like, hell, there's people who like the same thing I do. And it's a good feeling, right? You know, you may be the only person in your small town who likes board games like these behind me. But when you go on the internet, you find out that there's so many other people. And if you have very specific tastes, like for example, one of my favorite games is Duel of Ages. There's not a lot of people who like Duel of Ages. When I go online, I can find a lot of people who like Duel of Ages. I can find people who like collectible card games that have gone out of print 20 years ago, and people are still excited about them online. I can find that specific group of people, and I can talk to them online, and we can talk about games, and I can go to things and talk about something and not have someone go, board games, I think you mean board games. I don't deal with that because I meet people who have the same things that I do. I can game online. Wow, what an amazing thing. You can play games with people online. So if you don't have anyone to play Le Havre with, you can get out your iPad or go online and find these ways to play games with other people. Globalization. I really like this aspect of board gaming. For a long time, board gaming for me was where I was at. It didn't even occur to me as a teenager to think about games from other countries. If I did, it was like, oh, that's no big, you know, there's games in other countries. When I became an adult, I started hearing about these games from Germany. And these, in fact, for a long time, they weren't even called Euro games. They were called German games because that's where they came from. Jay Tummelson started bringing some of these games over. And again, corresponding because of the internet, suddenly I could find out about these games in Germany. I could find someone who translated the rules for these games, finding files for games on the internet. And now we're seeing games, we're seeing gamers from Japan and the Far East being involved in gaming. We're seeing gamers from South Africa, we're seeing all over Europe, it's just like exploding in America, and all these people are working together, we fly across the ocean and meet people overseas, and it's just a phenomenal, cool thing. I love globalization, I love meeting people from all different cultures and seeing those cultures invade board games and looking at, wow, this is a cool little French game that I found, and over here is a neat game that someone designed who lives in Cambodia. That stuff is just fascinating to me, and the internet has made that so much easier and so much more possible that two designers, one might live in France and the other lives in Singapore, and they can work together and make a game. That's just phenomenal. Friends. I have a lot of friends. I'm very fortunate in that regard. I met some of my best friends straight up because of the internet. I would never have met Eric Sommer without the internet. He lives in Connecticut. I don't go to Connecticut. But he listened to our show, started doing contributions for the show, and as time went by, he became a host of the show, and by doing that, became friends with him. I met Z because of the internet, because of typing online and saying, I'm moving to Miami, I'm looking for a game group, and found him that way. And there's so many other people, and I could list, you know, you watch this show, and you look at all these contributors on this show. They're my friends. But I met them because of the internet, and that's a fascinating thing to me. I got people here from England. I got people from all over the different corners of the world, even Canadians, joking. But just so many people that I have become good friends with, and I go to them, and I have a great time when I meet them at conventions. Some of them I've never met. Some of them I may never meet, and yet we're friends, and it's such a neat thing to do, to have friends that you have stuff in common with. And then finally, charity. Very shortly, I'm not sure the exact starting date. We'll announce it through our Twitter and Facebook feed. The Jack Vasel Memorial Fund is starting up, the auction for it. Now, if you never heard of the Jack Vasel Memorial Fund, and this is, again, I think such a fitting thing for Board Game Breakfast. I'm the president of the Dice Tower, but I'm also the president of the Jack Vasel Memorial Fund. This is a fund that was started because seven years ago, my son was born. It was November 15th. And he was born 2 months early, just happened that way, and he got meningitis when he was born. He lasted for 2 months, you know, and it was a big saga, really, again, on the internet, because we would post what was happening, we would talk about going to see him, and we have letters from all over the world because of the internet, right? And people supported us, and when Jack passed away in January the following year, just the overwhelming support, and so we made the Jack Vasel Memorial Fund. I'm the president of the Jack Vasel Memorial Fund. We get people emailing us, and they say some dire strait has happened. Something horrible has happened in our lives. Our house burned down. Someone was in an accident. Something happened. This operation we need for our child, we don't have the money for it. And we say, we do have the money for it. And we send them funds to help them in their time of need. Where do these funds come from? People on the internet. One of the biggest ways is this auction that's coming up. I mean, I've already seen the stuff that's in the auction is on Board Game Geek. I've already seen the first four pages. Publishers and people put up so many amazing things. And then people bid on these. And so the people who put the things up for auction are amazing. The people who bid on them for amazing. The people who cannot do neither but promote this to the four corners of the internet are amazing. And all that money that comes in there, and also money comes in, some people donate through the website. You can find it at jackvasel.org, are amazing. But you can go there and donate. We get money at DiceTowerCon, and all this money then is in this pool of money. And so we don't have to raise money for someone when they need help. We can say, here is the money right here and there. And the board is a committee of 9 different people that are involved in the industry in different ways. Myself, Eric Summer on board, and there are other people from publishers and designers and just other people involved in the industry in various ways. And it is an exciting thing. And things like this exist outside the internet. Again, I don't think the internet is some cure for all problems. And there's a lot of bad and a lot of wrong with the internet. But there's a lot of good things. The Dice Tower right now would not exist without you guys. It wouldn't. You know, someone mentioned a few weeks ago, they're like, just so you know, if the Dice Tower disappeared, board gaming would survive. Well, of course. We would never think that, right? No, I would hope that one would never be so arrogant to think that. I don't even think board game would have a speed bump if the Dice Tower disappeared. But that's not the point. We just want to promote gaming here. And the fact that it also became our jobs is unbelievable. I owe what I'm doing right now because of you guys. I haven't met many of you. I may not meet most of you. When you go up to a convention, know this. I appreciate you. I appreciate that we have this connection between us where I get to talk to you each week here and you can email back or put comments or you come talk to us at conventions, and we love that. Wow. We're so fortunate to live in such a blessed world, in such a connected world, and it's really cool. And when we go to Essen this week, it's like the culmination of all this, where I can see people, I meet people, and someone will come to me and say, thanks to the Jack Vasel Fund, look at my child here. That's fantastic. And that's amazing. And let's not get so caught up in negative because there's a ton of that on the internet. I know that. But there's so much positive, and I'm so thankful for that. All right, Enough of that. Let's keep going on with the show.
Hi. Today we're going to take a look at a show called Board Game Lunch. Wait, what? But I watch it during lunch. I'm sorry, I'm told the show is called Board Game Breakfast, despite the fact I don't think I've ever watched it during breakfast. Are you sure it's not Board Game Lunch? Okay. The show Board Game Breakfast, as it's called, had originally got its starts as Unnamed Board Game Show, hosted by a gentleman who went by the name of Thomas Vasel. Now, thankfully, the show became the Board Game Breakfast we love and know now, hosted by this guy with an eerily similar name, Tom Vasel. The show has had many contributors over the years and many great moments, such as the time when this guy decided to juggle swords while explaining to us what a dexterity game was. The show has had a host of contributors. Let's take a moment to look at a montage of those contributors. Quite the cast there. The show has also made some questionable decisions over the years in terms of the opening sequence, including the time that they decided that mustard was for breakfast. Let's take a look at a few of those, shall we? Some interesting choices there. In addition, there's also been the wardrobe choices over the years of the primary host. Let's do one last look at something, shall we? Let's take a look at some of the more colorful choices over the time. Kidding aside, this is the 200th episode of Board Game Breakfast, and I can't say that I have been more happy to join, even if for one episode. But let's be serious. We all know that we're here to see the real star of Board Game Breakfast, Cora. I hope you guys enjoy your breakfast and the rest of all the contributors for this episode, and take care.
Hey there, my name is Niels from the best and the worst, actually from Cyril's Brettspiel, but my segment here is the best and the worst, and you know that. Anyway, let's take a closer look to one of the old favorites of mine, the game. But hey, what's that? The game Extreme.
My favorite part on the game Extreme is simply that you can play it as the game Extreme or as the regular game. Simply ignore the seven new symbols if you wanted to play it as a regular game. And if you wanted to have a more challenging, higher competition, you simply add this seven symbols to the game and create Extreme out of it. The worst part is the flip side. If you already own the game, there is truly no real need for the game Extreme, except you need more challenge. If you find the other, the basic game, too easy, play it with Extreme. But there are other rules, so instead of playing two cards from your hand down, you can also add play three cards. That makes the game even more harder than the seven symbols. However, I pretty enjoyed the seven new symbols, and I would say if you don't own the game already, then buy the blue version instead of the red version. You get simply two in one.
Yeah, that was my favorite part of the game Extreme, and also the worst part of game Extreme from NSV. See you next week here on Board Game Breakfast. Tom, take over, please.
Hi, everyone. On November 18th of 2013, a big guy wearing a hat and an enormous heart for board games wanted to try something different, something new, or something that is kind of an evolution of things he'd done in the past. And that was the first episode of what we now know as Board Game Breakfast. And I must say, if it wasn't for Tom and Board Game Breakfast, I would have never started making my own videos and songs about board games. He got me started, and I'm very grateful that I get to do creative things with our beloved board games each week. So me and my wife Ilka would like to congratulate you, Tom. You are a great guy, and here's to 200 more episodes, at least.
This week we are playing a game that does something completely different.
Something new, or something that is kind of an evolution of something it has done in the past.
This week we are playing Catan, Legend of the Sea Robbers. Legend of the Sea Robbers is a Catan scenario that adds a bit of a legacy element to the game.
Yeah, although it's only four games that you play, it's a short scenario, every game you get stuff that you take with you until the end of the scenario.
Yeah, and like the title says, the legend explains how the sea robbers became a part of the Catan game.
It only has a few rule tweaks and a few new components that are very cool. And I love going back to the island. It's a great way to introduce new people, get them back into the game that got me into the board gaming hobby.
Yeah, and me as well. And I guess our son too, because he really likes playing Catan. And he is as excited as we are because Essen Week is finally here.
I will be making an Essen vlog each day, starting on Wednesday, so one day before, with some of the highlights that will be at Essen.
So you get an 8-minute video every day, Wednesday to Sunday.
And if you have any requests, then please send me a message. I will take a look at it and try to integrate it into the video. Last year, I had one of the questions that you asked answered by one of the designers, Uwe Rosenberg.
So have a great week, everyone. See you at Essen, because we are going to be there every day.
My name is Dave Luza.
I'm Ilka Luza.
Thanks for watching.
Bye. Bye.
Mike Felicio from Solomode Games. Before I get started, I wanted to say a special congratulations to Tom Vasel and the Dice Tower crew for this wonderful achievement of 200 episodes of Board Game Breakfast. That's really great. A special shout out to the contributors who have been there from the beginning. I'm thrilled to have been able to be brought on recently, and I hope to continue to do it. For this special episode, I wanted to do something a little bit different. I wanted to give my top 10 solo games of all time. I have not done this before, and let me tell you, I've been agonizing over this list, so I'm going to do it now, lock myself in, so that I don't have to go back and want to change these immediately. At number 10 is Nemo's War. This is a game that may actually rise up the rankings as I play it more. It's a relatively new acquisition to me. I got it this year at Gen Con. A really terrific thematic game based off of 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea with some amazing art by Ian O'Toole. Just a really intriguing game, very story-driven. Makes me want to get back and play it again, which is always a good sign. Nemo's War. At number 9 is Saltlands. This is a game that's kind of under the radar. It's got a post-apocalyptic theme, a very intriguing mashup of elements to it. It has a hex-based board, but it doesn't play like a hex-based game. If you can get a hold of Saltlands, give it a shot. I think you'd be surprised. At number 8 is a game that I'm calling a warts and all game, and that's Masmora Dungeons of Arcadia. This game has issues. I'm well aware of it. It's got some edge case rules that aren't really covered in the rule book. The rule book in general is a little bit more open-ended than I would like, leaving some ambiguities and rules questions, but it is just such a fun, dice-chucking, dungeon-crawling game that I just can't help myself. I really enjoy playing it. I also had the Arcadia Quest crossover that came with the Kickstarter, so I've got so many different characters I can play with. I really enjoy Masmora, Dungeons of Arcadia. At number 7 is Outlive, another game that's under the radar, and it's another post-apocalyptic themed game. Outlive is primarily a worker placement and resource management game, and while it has some of those familiar mechanics, it has enough of a twist to it that is really intriguing. It's kind of a Fallout Shelter, the board game, if you're familiar with that. At number 6 is one of my older favorites. It's Expedition Northwest Passage. This is a tile-laying game of exploration, as you might guess from the title, where you're trying to go from Greenland to the Northwest Passage and back, and there's this really intriguing weather mechanic where as the sun token goes around the edge of the board, different parts of the board become frozen or unfrozen, which affects your movement. Just a great classic game, Expedition Northwest Passage. And number 5 is Viticulture, and this is the first, but spoiler alert, not the last of the Automa systems for solo that is on my list. Viticulture is a worker placement game themed around running your own vineyard, and it is just such a smooth and elegant game, thematically integrated, just a wonderful game. And number 4 is A Beast, A Feast for Odin. A huge Uwe Rosenberg worker placement game. Just getting the box off the shelf is a workout. This thing weighs a ton. It has a lot of spaces and the first worker placement spaces, and the first time you see it, it might seem overwhelming, but really it's not. It has the elegance that you come to expect with an Uwe Rosenberg game. He's kind of the king of worker placement, and this is, to me, his biggest and most impressive achievement, A Feast for Odin. And number 3 is Anachrony. This game is one that's very new to me. I've only played it a few times. It has knocked me out. Just an incredible game with a time travel theme and a really, really great AI system for the solo opponent. It has a board that's specific to the solo opponent, a chronobot it's called, and you roll dice, and depending on the die roll, it will do a certain action. Just a really great way to have an actual opponent that you're playing against, which I always appreciate and prefer in a solo game. And number 2 is Explorers of the North Sea, and this is especially with the upcoming Rocks of Ruin expansion that's not quite out yet, but I play-tested the expansion, the prototype, and it is wonderful. I can't wait for the finished product. It's just a great tile-laying exploration game. So much fun. Explorers of the North Sea. And my number 1 solo game of all time is Scythe. And it's not even really close. I absolutely adore this game. I love the Automa solo system. I love the art. I love the world that has been created. The resource management, the player boards, everything about this game is absolutely fantastic. The expansion that added the new factions and the upcoming Wind Gamut airships, I can't wait for. So my number 1 solo game of all time is Scythe. I'd be interested to hear what your favorite games are, solo or otherwise. If you'd let me know in the comments below, I'd love to hear it. Thank you so much for your time as always, and have a great day.
So Tom told us contributors to really bring the house down this week for the 200th episode, and I have nothing. So I'm Gary Pope from Late to the Table, and this is What Should I Get, where usually we recommend games on the Board Game subreddit to people that ask questions. But this week we're not going to do that. But how do you make a show that's so spectacular any more spectacular than it already is? Do you do it with a rhyme? That seems to work every time. No. No, you definitely don't do it in a rhyme. Do you do it from a different angle? No. No, not from a different angle. That doesn't work either.
Do you do it outdoors? No. But do you do it outdoors while possibly saying something inspirational like, how about we try something where instead of trying to figure out something to get for yourself, you get something for someone else?
Wait, no. No, you definitely don't do that, especially when the video can be removed because of the music. Did you complain that the Reddit community is doing such a good job that you no longer have anything to do at work because they're answering the questions so quickly and so efficiently? No, you definitely don't do that. I mean, if anything, you should be thanking Reddit, if anything. I mean, it is still Reddit, after all, so I guess it's fine then? Seriously though, Reddit gets a lot of flack and is often showing their ugly side, but what a lot of people miss out on is all of the posts, all of the questions, all of the positive reinforcement, all of the people answering all of the questions that people are having, from the very obvious all the way to the extremely obscure, and it's something that a lot of people don't notice when they don't go to Reddit that often. It seems almost like a bad place to go, but in reality, it's actually a very nice community there that a lot of people don't, I guess you could say, understand. So I guess that's a high note to end on, if I guess then at that point. Is that as good as it's going to get? And that was another episode of Wish I Could. Be sure to ask your questions on the board game subreddit, and the Reddit community will go ahead and answer your questions for you, for the better or the worse. No, I'm just kidding, guys. And this is Gary Pope from Lattes at the Table, and I hope you're enjoying your breakfast.
Hey, this is Mike with Focus on Board Games, a new segment where I bring you games that are easy for you to concentrate and focus throughout, because I have that problem. And long games are very difficult for me to stay focused on what I'm trying to do. Well, these games are not going to be very long, or the rules are simple enough that you can keep focusing throughout the game. Do you like dogs? I bring you Dog Pile. Do you like cats? Let me know, I'll send you a recipe. Just kidding. Cat Stacks. These are two abstract games I'm going to show you because they're very fun to play. The pieces are amazing. They look like this and that, and the dogs. They're all different color. I'll show you that and how easy this game is to play. It's pretty quick, obviously, but still, it's a good abstract game. Makes you concentrate, makes you think, and just one of the first games I want to show you is Dog Pile and Cat Stacks.
Dog Pile and Cat Stacks are very similar games. In fact, I would consider these games to be identical except for the different components, one being dogs, one being cats. Both games have the same objective, where you try to arrange a series of dogs or cats on a grid so they perfectly fit the illustrated shape. Each card tells you exactly which cats or dogs you'll need in order to cover this entire grid. Half of the cards are the solution, and the other half are beginner, intermediate, and advanced, and of course, expert. In this particular puzzle, we need these five cats, so I've got them out, and what you want to do is try to fit them on this grid so they work out perfectly. We need to cover the entire grid. There. Well, maybe not. And of course, the solution will help you figure out the puzzle and cover the entire grid the way that it's supposed to be done to win.
Well, I hope you enjoyed my first episode of Focus on Board Games, and I'm hoping that I can bring you some great ideas for games. If you have trouble focusing and concentrating in games for a long period of time, these shorter games might be perfect for you as they are for me. And Cat Stacks and Dog Pile, great little games that don't take very long to play, but they're abstract and their pieces are awesome. Thanks for watching. I will see you next time.
Wait, I'm not just watching Board Game Breakfast, I'm in it. Congratulations on 200 episodes of Board Game Breakfast. I love watching the show to get caught up on the news in the board gaming industry from Tom, and all the Kickstarter stuff from Suzanne, and the amazing crazy stuff that Chaz comes up with every week. All the contributors are amazing, and it's been awesome to see new ones come on and all the switch out and great amazing contributors that we have now on Board Game Breakfast. I watch it every single week like I know a ton of you do. Amazing job for 200 episodes, and here's to 200 more. Keep it up.
It is October, and October means Halloween, and Halloween for gamers means games about spooks, specters, zombies, vampires, monsters, aliens, and more. Spooky-themed games are a perennial favorite, and more horror games get released every single year. One of my personal favorite mechanics for horror games is the one versus the many.
Oh no, look at all those zombies! Brains!
Classic one versus many games are like Fury of Dracula or Letters from Whitechapel. So if you can get your hands on those, give them a play. But every single year, more and more come out. Not Alone from Stronghold Games and designer Geistlinger Masson puts the players in the shoes of astronauts who have crash-landed on a distant alien world, and they are trying to survive long enough to get saved by the rescue ship that is hopefully on its way. But as the title suggests, the humans are not alone on this planet. One player is an alien predator who is hunting them down and trying to assimilate their bodies. It is a desperate game of cat and mouse and mouse and mouse. From Upper Deck Entertainment and designers Richard Lanius and Pete Sheary comes this one versus many game, Shark Island. In this game, one player is the great white shark feeding in the waters off the coast of Shark Island, and the other players are various fishermen, oceanographers, and law enforcement personnel who are all trying to catch and kill the great white shark. Now, the game does have a lot of moving parts and lots of pieces, but none of the rules to the game are particularly complicated, so it's actually pretty easy to learn how to play. Plus, barrel! Antonio Ferrara and Sebastiano Ferrio bring us another one versus many horror game in Last Friday. Now, I've had my eyes on this one for a while, I just haven't had a chance to play it yet, but come on, psycho killers and co-eds? What more could you want in a hidden movement one versus many horror game? Arctic isolation is a popular theme this Halloween because not only has IDW put out Outpost Siberia by Daryl Andrews and John Gilmore, but the movie The Thing, possibly the greatest horror movie ever made, has inspired not one but two games in the form of Who Goes There and The Thing Outpost 31. So this Halloween month, I hope to get Mall of Horror and Dead of Winter to the tables. What Halloween-themed games are you looking to play? Let us know in the comments below. Spooky, spooky comments.
Hello, my name's Dan, and today I'm going to be continuing my series on things I did wrong when I was trying to get my eldest daughter into board gaming. Becoming frustrated at concentration lapses. Now, this is a big one, really, and I think this is the one that turned Amy off gaming completely. People who know me in real life will tell you I'm a bit of a grumpy person, and that's putting it lightly. I can be quite irritable at times, and I can be quite intolerant at times. Not all the time. I try my best to be tolerant and calm with my kids, although I certainly don't achieve that all the time. But my grumpiness leaks out around the edges, especially when people take a long time taking their turns. I can't cope with that. And Amy was taking a long time taking her turns because she was not particularly invested in playing these games, because she didn't particularly want to play these games at that time. She started getting distracted. She started talking about something else. She started daydreaming. Her eyes started wandering around the room, and I got frustrated and I told her off. I scolded her for not paying attention. And so games had gone from being a bit disquieting and then to being a bit of a chore to being something that she was regularly being told off during. And that killed it. That killed it for her. I think she no longer wanted to play any games with me. And to be honest, I don't blame her. And that makes me sad. I feel that I've closed this chapter off for Amy, this potential hobby off for her. One that I really love, one that we could have shared together because of my poor parenting skills, really, my lack of patience and my lack of realisation of what my behaviour was doing to my daughter. If she wants to come back to gaming, she can do. She's very more than welcome. I'd love to have her and Cora and Evan round the table all playing a game together. That'd be my dream. But it's my fault, not her fault, that she doesn't want to do that. And you know, I'm just going to have to leave the door open, but not push her through it. Okay, so I hope that was of use or of interest to some people. Normal service will be resumed next week with your nice cute Cora and pretending that I'm a good dad. so So thanks very much for indulging me, and see you next time.
Well, hello. I'm not dead. Well, other than on the inside. I'm in America, but it's, I'm in Tennessee, actually. The middle of nowhere, Tennessee, to be precise. It's a little spooky, but other than that, I'm having a good time. Now, I'm not here to talk about that, because that, of course, is boring. So what I am going to tell you is that, just a quick update on how my board gaming life is going. Haven't played any games in a very long time. I'm getting kind of antsy. It's all right, but it's not all right. But I have found some great buys. Buy one, looking for the camera. Found this thrift store, $4. There were two. That's cool. Second thing I bought, Eclipse Pro, Ultra Pro Eclipse sleeves. I may or may not have gotten into Magic the Gathering, and it may or may not have changed my life a little bit. Only a tiny bit. It's very casual. But apparently, these sleeves are great. So I got some of those. Also, I got my friend Mike from over the Board Game Makeover, who is 100 of fantastic, because he picked a game up for me at Gen Con. I know. The game was Heart of Crown, and I'm very excited about it. So I finally got hold of that. That's probably a very loud thud, and for that I apologise. Although the real reason I'm here, giving this little update, is to say it's episode 200 of Board Game Breakfast, which is a lot of episodes. So just wanted to say hello, and congratulations to Tom, really, for doing such a good job all the time, and to all the contributors for being great, and to you guys for just existing. That's pretty marvellous. And anyway, I'll be back in a few weeks. Some of you are happy about that, others of you, I know, aren't. But we'll be alright.
And that's it for another Board Game Breakfast. We're going to be at Essen. Make sure you come by and say hi to us. We're excited about that. Cool videos coming your way. Man, I can't believe it. Pandemic Legacy is being announced this week. Being launched this week. That's great. You're going to all be able to play that. We have a full review of that going up, so you'll be able to see that. I think that's going up Tuesday and such. And we'll be doing our playthroughs in the future. We don't want to spoil everything, but some people will probably want to watch it. You should get it. It's amazing. Okay. It's time. Essen is here. I'll see many of you there. Remember, we'll be a little bit late next week, a day or so. Until then, I'm Tom Vasel, and you've been watching Board Game Breakfast.